Hello everyone, this is Randy Malde. Just want to get back with you about the questions and answers that we received for the rapid response planning process. We had a little bit of technical difficulty earlier, so we had to revert to this recording where I'm going to go through the questions with you. And then if you have additional questions, you can go ahead and just send me an email and I'll be happy to respond to those as we're going through to make sure that you have everything you need to be more successful. The coronavirus, as you know, has truly affected the United States by making us work from home in a virtual environment. In addition to that, as a procurement professional, you're most likely involved in day-to-day operations to ensure that your organization is receiving the requirements it needs to move forward, servicing customers, producing products, doing whatever it may be that it needs to do to in order to support your particular company or your customer base in your market, whatever it might be. And if you're a government agency, I know you're doing this because you have to provide services to your company, to your guys. Now this is, you see the USNS Comfort went to New York, and to get there, they had to go through this process that we're talking about now, rapid supply chain process, planning process, R2P2 is what they call it, rapid response planning process. And this is where they go through a drill that they've well rehearsed and they've trained for to rapidly produce a solution to a problem that they're being exposed to. And that's why they were able to deliver that ship 3 weeks earlier than originally planned, because they did what they could and they quickly prioritized. And those are some of the things that we're going to talk about today. Now, it hasn't had a supply chain impact. As you can see, the headlines are there showing how the coronavirus has impacted the supply chain. You can just go out your front door and see where your roads are not as congested as they used to be. The demand for things is just not there the way it used to be. So you want to be involved and you want to be part of the process and the supply chain. Your procurement folks are that solution. That whatever ideas they're coming up with, they have to be resourced. They have to come with stuff, and you're the person that's going to give them that stuff. Now, some of the common mistakes you receive or experience when you're planning is, one, lack of integration. Do you have the right people involved in your planning process? And are you making assumptions that may prove to not be correct because you don't have the right people in the room? So you want to look at data. You want to make sure you have the right people in the room to give you the data that you're looking for so they can make the best decision possible. And one thing we need to talk about is, beware of, we call it, you know, the armchair quarterback, the person who is sitting in the back, you know, dinging you and criticizing your decision, but they're not in the room at that moment able to make decisions or making decisions. They just get to sit back and say, well, you should have made a different decision. Well, I didn't have all the data. I didn't have all the information. I made the best decision possible based on the information that I had. All right. Mistakes that you experience with CEOs is that you may be treating a symptom versus the actual problem. An example of that would be face masks. What is the problem when it comes to face masks? Well, the problem is being exposed to the virus in the air, either intentionally, unintentionally. You have the virus passing it to someone else, or they have the virus and you don't want to receive it. So the issue is not face mask. The issue is, how do I protect myself from receiving the virus through an airborne activity? And we can do that through face mask. We can do that through social distancing, which we are experiencing right now. A lot of us are at home working from home virtually. So that's a focus on the actual problem versus a symptom of the problem. Focus on your priorities. What are your top priorities? Every day you should be having a meeting with the people in your organization to identify what the priorities are for that day. They shift, they change. The priorities from yesterday don't apply to today. An example would be in New York City when they wanted 20,000 ventilators because they were going to have such big problems. And yet today, they don't have that high need of 20,000 ventilators. They need a number that's much smaller than that. Now priorities are shifting. And the hotspot of New York City is shifting further down the coast. It's now Baltimore, Washington, D.C., Louisiana, going other places to where they need to move those ventilators from over here to over there to wherever they need to go. So understanding what your priorities are based on the current situation and being able to respond to that. Making sure we don't make false assumptions, that whenever we assume something, we validate that assumption to make sure that the data is true, that the assumptions we're making according to that data are true and valid, and that the things we're envisioning happening actually makes sense. That's why you want to have a diverse team with the right experience and the right people in the room so they can all give their specific input. Mistakes you want to avoid when you're actually planning is drilling. When you get to downtime, you've taken care of the things for today, then you want to anticipate what's going to happen tomorrow and drill the process. Finding the right information, finding the right vendors, finding the right people you need every day. What you've done before today doesn't matter. It's what you're doing right now. If you have a planning process, that's great. If not, that's okay too. Now you got to implement it, but you got to rehearse it every day, and you will get better every day by practicing the process. If you don't practice the process, then when the problem pops up, you're then scrambling trying to get it done, and you don't want to have that experience. Are you communicating to the right people? Are you communicating the correct information? Do they know it? What we would say is, who needs to know it? What do they need to know? And have I told them? So those are the things you want to make sure that you're looking at every day. And I have the right information, is it getting to the right person, and have I made sure they receive that information and are able to take action on it? Looking at outdated, misplaced, or misbroken equipment, outdated, obsolete equipment, thinking about how we communicate. We rely heavily on the internet. What if the internet goes out? What are you going to do? Have you thought about that process? Do you have cell phones? Well, if the internet's out, maybe the cell phones are out. Do you have hardwire phones? Have you thought about maybe even a ham radio? That's old school, but that cannot be corrupted by the internet. That might be something that you have to think about. How do we relay? How do we do radio communications? If you're talking from one campus to another, one organization to another, and do they have the right means of communicating? Do they know how to communicate on the radio so that it's not all jammed up, because everyone wants to get on the radio at one time, then all of a sudden it's not working right? Do we have assigned channels for specific activities? You know, the whole radio plan, that's how the military does it. You know, if you're thinking about how do I set up a radio, you know, ask those questions. Got to find one first. Believe it or not, there's a ham radio society already out there and available that you could probably tap into. You just got to look for them and find them and get them engaged in the process. And make sure you're updating your plan every single day, looking at the right data at the right time. Now, we had some specific questions come in to help us prepare for today. And even though I may not be able to receive your questions live, if you send me a live question or a question, then what I will do is respond to that question down below in the comments so we can keep a rolling conversation about things that you need to know, things you need to answer. Now, how do you respond to changing demand? That's that daily activity. Reassessing your current situation. What do I have? What don't I have? What is my priority? Who should be involved in that? And making sure that we're constantly updating things. And then once the day is set for the day, then project what your next needs are. Think, envision, what are the potential problems? And these are, at the moment when we're projecting, these are burning electrons and brain cells. We're not actually doing the actual ordering yet or committing money and people to doing the things. We're just thinking and finding resources, calling those vendors, making sure that they're actually working and still in business and still open for business. So how do I anticipate, respond? Is constantly updating, constantly reprioritizing, constantly making sure things are coming together. How do you get a supplier to do business with your company if they expect the volume of business to be too small for their liking? Great question. Consortiums, cooperatives, teaming with other organizations that have a similar need so you can get to that minimum volume quantity. Having that ability to respond, putting everyone together. If you have one campus and you can't order enough to meet their minimum threshold, call the other campuses that would be able to consolidate on that requirement. If you're a business and you need something and they say, well, you're not meeting our minimum threshold, then call other businesses that need it also and put together one order for everyone so that you meet that minimum threshold. So instead of buying things you're not going to use, look at other ways to get that requirement, build up your numbers, build a cooperative, build a consortium, build something now that you can actually start to tap into consistently, because everyone's going to have similar requirements. Think of all the small businesses out there. How do I order stuff? I'm just not that big. I don't need that much stuff. Well, if all the small businesses get together, then you have a larger requirement that fills that need. You just need to coordinate the ordering, the paying, all that stuff needs to be coordinated. Again, another reason to start exercising the process. Everything's kind of settling down right now because everyone's at home. But once they open the doors and people go back out into society, we can expect more information to come out to make people respond to that information. What we think we have under control, it's nature, it's Mother Nature. And the one thing I've learned being an avid outdoors person is that if you think you know what's going on, Mother Nature's going to show up and tell you what you don't know. And so think about that. You know, when the virus starts to get exposed and things start to change and morph, are we prepared for it? So you need to be ready. You need to be ready. Where do you suggest one starts predicting future supply needs when you can't utilize past year's spend data because of the supply chain disruption and change from physical to virtual business? Great question. How do I anticipate demand when I haven't been in this situation before? But it doesn't mean this situation has not happened before. We had the swine flu, we had SARS, we've had similar situations similar to this. What happened back then? What happened to a populated area when a biological threat hit that area, and what did they do to respond? And what we do is we take that population, let's use a simple number, so let's say 100,000 people, and then there were percentages within that population. And then you take those percentages and then you apply them to your population. Okay, so you have 100,000 in this population, and of that population, 10% needed face masks, 5% needed ventilators, 25% needed toilet paper. You know, you keep going down the road, and then you take that those percentages and apply them to your population, and let's say your population is 10,000. Well, now you can say, okay, 10% of 10,000 is 1,000, 25% of 10,000 is 2,500, and then you start to get an idea. Now, can that change? It's just a point of planning, and then you validate that assumption. Say, okay, we think we need 1,000 ventilators. What's going on currently to where I need to go and validate? Do I need 1,000 or do I need less than 1,000? We call the hospital. How many do we need? How many have you used in the past? What does it look like? How are things going? Are you using them faster or slower? Do we have time to respond? Can we get those? If I get you 1,000 ventilators, where are you going to put them? How are you going to set them up? Do you have space to use them? So that's another question. Think about that. A space to use them. 4,000 ventilators go to New York City. Where can they use them? They don't have the hospital beds yet. They have to build the hospitals, the beds, and then bring the ventilators in to put them on the beds in the hospitals. See how it starts to think when you start to think through it? What is the problem and solve the entire problem, not the symptom that is being exposed on media or something to that effect, okay? One of the biggest challenges that we're seeing out there, and I asked one of those questions, what's the biggest challenge? The biggest challenge is the spirit of employees. What are we going to do in an uncertain time? How do I bring certainty? Well, that's where you need to engage and talk and speak to people. Get the word out. How can I help? Shift your market from here to there. What can I do? You see examples of that in the media. Ford, for example, went from making cars to making ventilators. We can make stuff. We can manufacture stuff. If I can't make a car, then I'll make a ventilator. Same thing for you. Think about what you need. What are your priorities, and shift and change and go into other markets. If you're looking for markets, look to the government. They need to partner with vendors. So go find the government representative. How do I find a representative? Call FEMA, call your local Chamber of Commerce, call your local Emergency Operations Center. Say, what are your needs? What are your anticipated needs? Get involved in those planning sessions so you can hear what the needs are going to be, so you can anticipate and be there. Learn their processes. If an emergency center, FEMA or local Emergency Operations Center, needs something, how do they place the order? Where do they go? Do they have a system? Are you registered in their system to be a vendor for them for that situation? If you haven't done those steps, then you can't respond anyway. Even if you have the perfect solution, they can't give that business to you because you're not registered in their system. So you need to register and find the process. Another reason, to do the planning process. How are you going to get paid? Do you need to have credit? Do you have a credit line set up with the bank? All those different things need to come into play, but you've got to think about it. You've got to talk about that. Another big challenge came up, a job. Says, Randy, I need a job. What am I going to do? It's like, well, how have you prepared for the next opportunity? When you were thinking about a job, you said, well, I didn't need a job, so I'm not going to do anything now. And that's one of the things, the reason we started RFX Academy, because everything takes time, to where people need to jump on those planning processes and think about just yourself. Well, is my resume up to date? Have I been on LinkedIn? Have I been networking with the right people that can give me an opportunity or give me the opportunity to do something different? Have I demonstrated my expertise? Have I separated myself from everyone else? Have I started to build out those skill sets that they're going to be looking for, such as rapid response planning process, rapid supply chain planning, resilient supply chain? These are the things you need to start thinking about, is what is the next need and am I in position to get that need? Can I demonstrate my expertise? Okay. Now, what we want to do is take this information that we provided in this short amount of time, and we just a little bit over 15 minutes, okay, and create an action plan for that. What is my action plan? Is what are you going to do right now? Do you have an emergency operations center planning process in place? Have you established it? Have you identified your local points of contact? Have you anticipated the need that you need right now? And have you started making those phone calls, identifying sources of supply? If you're a vendor listening to this, have you established registration with the companies you can respond to and deliver for? If you're looking at FEMA, then have you set up with FEMA? Okay, think about these things. What can I do? How can I provide assistance to a community when things have changed within the community? How am I going to do that? Okay, if you're a business and just thinking maybe a hair salon, how am I going to do hair in the new business? Well, what do you have? You have a facility. You have chairs where people can rest. Are you an option to set up places for people to go to give blood? Are you an option for people to go to be on a ventilator? Are you an option to go and be something? And I'm talking about just a salon. Talk about your restaurants. Do you have the means of mass production of food? Do you have food to offer? You have the access to the vendors who provide food and start tapping into those. Well, how much rice do I need to have? I may not be able to give rice. Maybe I need to get something else, some other longer term, something that's not going to spoil right away. And so you need to start asking these questions. How can I help? And then where do I tap into that? Instead of waiting to be told what to do, time to start to take action and go do something. Instead of waiting for something to happen to you, start doing that. Call your local campuses. Call your college campus. Call your high schools. Call your emergency operations center. Call your electric department. What are your needs? How can I fill those needs? How are you going to be involved in operations? Fuel. Can I bring fuel to you? Can I set up an operations center? Can I set up a distribution center? Can I be a distribution center? What can I do? So those are things you need to think about as a vendor. What are you going to do? So make your action plan. Now our next webinar is Resilient Supply Chain Management, Building a Supply Chain Resilience. Okay, here's the website. Definitely go in there, click on the button, register for that, because that's going to be next week. And we're going to talk about all the ways to build that resilient supply chain. Because where you are today, that's it. That's what you have. But start thinking and anticipating the future and how you're going to build out your supply chain. If you want the mind map of our R2P2, RSCP2 process, go ahead and go to this link, get the mind map guide, send me a link on Oya, which is the way that I can send that. I can give you right access to that mind map so that you can use it on your own. And of course, I'd love to share with you a book that I wrote with my dissertation when I was getting in the service, is Supply Chain Management by the Marine Corps During Operation Iraqi Freedom and How People Made the Difference. All this technology that people have had for years and years and years, you may have a great ERP system. What happens when that system fails, when the internet falls apart and you can't access that data? What are you going to do? We talk about that in the book because that's what the Marine Corps had to do. They were in the midst of changing between two systems. And then we went to war. Based on what happened is the people stood up and they made things happen. They communicated outside normal channels. They did whatever it took to be successful in that operation. And that's the mindset you need to have right now. What does it take? And do I have the flexibility of thinking to get to the next level? Am I picking up the phone? Have I set up a radio? Do I have these things in place? And if not, what does it take to get them in place? Can I start moving forward? It may be all for nothing. Okay, and I pray it is all for nothing, that things go back to normal sooner than later. But the reality is, you need to have the ability to make change now. And if you don't have that process in place, at least that thinking process, then you're behind. You need to start thinking differently. And if you read this book, you'll find out how people made the difference. I'll be glad to send you a copy. Just send me an email at info@cpsmtraining.com or connect with me on LinkedIn, Dr. Randall Malden on LinkedIn. Be happy to share a copy of that book with you there, whatever it takes to get that copy so you can start to learn those lessons that we learned when I was back in the service way back when. And it'll make sense. What you're going to find is all these tools and all this technology and all this crazy bells and whistles that you've been using for years and years and years, and all of a sudden, it fails. What are you going to do? If you're not thinking, you're wrong. You have to think. Use the brain, because the computer's not going to tell you what to do now. And if you're not prepared for that, you need to get prepared. Okay? So with that, I'm going to go ahead and put this video together, process it, render it, send it out to everyone that registered for this question and answer session, as well as put it out on YouTube so other people can benefit from it as well. I look forward to working with you. If you have any questions, just place a question in the comment. Connect with me on LinkedIn. Ask me that question on LinkedIn. I'll respond as quickly as I can. And if anything, be safe out there. Take care of your family. Get ready for what's next, because we all don't know what it is. It's going to be something different. And are you in a position to fill that need, whatever that need may be. With that, have a wonderful day, and we'll talk to you soon.